Good afternoon. This is Lauren Sutherland with Zone 5. We're here at SemiCon West in San Francisco. With me today is Dean Freeman, Research Vice President, Semiconductor Manufacturing for Gartner. Dean, the first question I would have of you is one who has come to SemiCon over the years as first a customer and then a supplier and now as a leading analyst. Has your perspective of the show itself changed?
Well, since that has been spread out over 29 years, yes, it has.
I wasn't trying to give your age.
Yeah. Everybody tells me I'm ageless. The show has changed from very much a format for people to show and tell, show off their wares, show off their goods, to more of an overall networking event where people converse and talk from the overall equipment and customer perspective. However, the show has also transitioned to where instead of semiconductor equipment manufacturers showing off their equipment, you now have component suppliers and vendors having room on the floor to show off their goods. So you're starting to see actually more equipment engineers on the floor looking around, seeing what widgets or gadgets are out there. Can I, add? What's going to add value to my piece of hardware and improve my overall cost of ownership? The other thing that you've seen change in the overall show, at least from the customer to the analyst perspective, is just that it's now more of before it was you would get purchase orders on the show floor, and you could actually make a year at SemiCon West by bringing out a new piece of equipment and demonstrating that to your customer, and they'd walk in with a PO and say, here you go, I want 30 of these for the year, and you go, thank you very much, and shut down your booth and come back to the factory and start building them. Now it's more where you're continuing to work on the relationship with that customer during this show. Customers will come in, you'll have customer vendor briefings. They'll talk about their desires and needs, kind of a annual checkup where they can come in and see all management at once and give them their opinion as to how that company is doing for the year. So it has transitioned from the Wild West down in San Mateo to a much more mature type of trade show where there's not as much business transacted, but there's much more here are wants, needs, desires, and roadmaps going out for the future. What are you going to do to meet those roadmaps for me if you want to continue to be my customer?
Yeah. As an analyst, I would imagine the majority of your last few days has been spent giving market updates, giving presentations. I know you're very popular on panels. Do you still get an opportunity to go on the show floor? And if so, what takes you there?
Yeah, the time I spend on the show floor is mostly running between booths or running between clients. So I don't get as much time on the show floor as I would like because you really start to get a flavor for what's out there, what the business picture is like by how the people in the booths are body language presenting, how many customers are out there. So when I do get on the show floor now, it's more for networking, trying to make sure I touch base with the people that I have not been able to catch up with recently or seen at any of the other events. And it's also sometimes to go ahead when I hear of a new technology or a new potential client for Gartner to go seek out that customer on the floor and check out what they have and introduce myself. So it's on the show floor, it's more networking and then trying to get a feel for what the pulse of the industry is by all the equipment suppliers that are there. We only serve I don't want to say select few, but a small cross-section of the overall industry. And so here you get a much better picture of what some of the smaller vendors are doing as well as what some of the bigger vendors are doing.
given the luxury of time, do you get an opportunity to attend things like today's 450-millimeter transition?
Unless they invite me to be on the panel, unfortunately, no. Because typically, if I don't have that time blocked out, I'm usually visiting with clients. So, you know, for example, my colleague Bob Johnson was on the panel.
Right.
So I figure he's going to take good notes and get back to me and let me know what happened there.
He actually asked some very damn good questions to the audience.
Yeah.
Because he didn't have all the answers.
Yes. Yes. So it's, I would love to attend the panels, but because of the demands placed on me by clients, I typically don't have the opportunity to spend a lot of time on there.
Yeah. For folks who are watching this and maybe reading a write-up on it, if you could tell us typically who are the clients for Gartner, especially for your expertise?
I cover all of semiconductor equipment manufacturing and a lot of emerging technology. So, you know, kind of a big cross section is we have IBM, AMD, GlobalFoundries back on the East Coast. We have most of the major semiconductor equipment companies: Applied, Lam Research, Varian, Hitachi High-Tech, Tokyo Electron. So most of those customers are here at the show, and I've met with most of them during this week.
Global's Foundries, which is building the fab in upstate New York right now, certainly has had a big footprint here at the show this year. And that brings up a good point. Zone 5 was lucky enough to be involved and help create the original New York Lives Nano campaign back in, I think, the mid-2000s, which has, in my own personal opinion, led to Global Foundries building the fab and the whole industry infrastructure exploding back there. Any perspective on the impact of Tech Valley, its growth, and how that hits this show?
Well, I think Tech Valley, you know, if you look at the United States semiconductor industry, there's kind of two coasts. There's Intel out here on the West Coast that actually buys equipment, and there's the Global Foundries and the rest of the tech consortium back there that also purchases equipment. So from a semiconductor industry and equipment perspective, the Tech Valley now is one of the more important zones for our industry, for the equipment manufacturers to focus on. And I think that's why you do see so many equipment manufacturers from overseas still continuing to be here at the show, and why we also see quite a few folks from the Tech Valley out here demonstrating as well as attending to visit with the equipment manufacturers.
A closing question would be, you know, you and I started coming to the show when there was maybe 25,000 attendees, predominantly engineers, fab managers, a lot of equipment on the floor, a lot of tech programs. I think at the height we got 45,000 attendees when we first got to San Francisco. This year we're probably looking at about 20 to 22,000. Depending on what somebody wants to report.
Yeah.
And you touched on it, the real value proposition, unless you're a subsystem supplier selling to an OEM here, which seems to be what's happening on the floor, the value proposition is the networking. Where do you see the show in, say, 3 years?
Very good question. I think Simi's asking that same question themselves, and with the leadership change, it'll be interesting to see where what happens. One of the things I notice at the show is there's a lot of competing entities. You've got, you know, Semitech with all of their programs, because it's a great place to get all the engineers together for a week of meetings to look at ITRS. You've got Simi with their specification meetings, and sometimes those are in technical meetings, and sometimes those two technologies or data overlaps. And then you have third parties like us that also have reports and meetings that we're trying to do. And all of the vendors have their technical symposiums as well.
I'm not sure we had IMEC join.
Yeah, IMEC came in. So I think what has to be looked at is, where is the overlap, where is the redundancy, and let's start to eliminate it. And let's start to, as we mentioned earlier, there's so much going on that you don't even have to go on the show floor. You know, you can find enough to do that you don't even see, you know, Moscone at all, unless that's where your technical needs is. So I think they need to kind of get back to the roots where, okay, this is a trade show. They need to take a look at, you know, the overall economics of it for their customers. So what does this serve for, you know, the equipment vendors? What does it serve for sub-suppliers? Most of the equipment vendors have pulled out because A, it's too expensive, and B, the value they get being on the show floor is better served by, you know, having a hotel room or a customer VIP party,
right,
rather than, you know, giving out, you know, hundreds of lanyards and some sort of Gumby pin or, you know, something to bounce along the wall that lights up when you hit it on the ground, yeah, and give some of the company's advertisement. So I think you'll see a more streamlined show in the future. I think they're going to have to figure out what to do with the intersolar part of it, because, you know, if I look at it right now, Moscone West is full, bulging over into the North Hall these days. And so do we take the semiconductor stuff and stick it west now?
And let
intersolar and there's other areas that you could bring in as well. You know, you could take a look to expand it into LED equipment. How much more do we pull MEMS into this? Because MEMS really is kind of still out there in orbit. It's not really been pulled in yet. So I think there's things Simi can look at with the other organizations that participate here at West to streamline and make a much, much better user experience for both the equipment manufacturers as well as the engineers that are attending.
Dean, we thank you for your time, and we look forward to your recap of the show and your next forecast.
All right. Thanks very much, Warren.